won by Shizak, Frederick Shizak, my supervisor, and the package is called MG Fund. Actually, another very good implementation is by Christopher Kuchan, also from RISC. The package is holonomic functions. And here, we implement our ideas, and then we check more other kind of look works, not just look work, and also some clean works, and also some random example, because to test what's the performance of the implementation. And then it turned out that the idea here actually is can gain some speed up. So if you are interested in more examples...
So this is much, much faster.
Yes. Because and if you want to see, actually, we test this implementation for more than 100 different kind of works. So if you are interested, you can visit many course web page, and you can find more timing and some. Yeah. Also, even you can download the implementation if you are need in your research.
And it's all proven rigorously.
Sure, sure.
It's not a conjecture.
Because we have this equivalence maybe in this seminar we should modulate this genius, but the genius can help you to bind the order of the telescope. Ah, so there's sometimes it's very useful.
Okay,
so the first part of the talk actually is about continuous things. So I only consider something is integrability problem. Actually, recently I get some result which is kind of so-called discrete analog of my previous result. Here, instead of the relation with respect to x, you replace this by difference. So what's the meaning? Difference is you shift x by x plus 1, and then you take the difference. And then here, the difference, you replace this dy derivative with respect to y by this difference. And then the summability here, now instead of integrability problem, now is summability problem. So you want to decide whether a rational function in x and y is equal to sum of two difference. And also there is a Q analog of this problem. And so recently we have this answer of these two questions. Actually you can view these two questions as a kind of generalization of Picard's criteria in the discrete and the Q-discrete case. So why I study this? Actually, there are some application of this criteria. So for instance, in the literature, there are many identity which is between the double sums and some linear combination of single sums. And actually, how you can show this this identity, for instance, this Tollenhayes identity. The idea actually to prove this identity, here let me recall that zeta s is this Riemann zeta function. So the idea is by our criteria, we can claim that for this rational function, which is in M and N, there exists another two rational function, which is sum of two difference. And then you, for once you have this one, you apply this double sum to both sides of this identity. And then you can simplify this one. And then into the single one, also this you get single. Then you get this zeta t and the zeta t minus one. So. And also, for instance, there's some new identity I can got. For instance, here if you, here is a rational function is 1 over m plus n over 2. This kind of double sign is quite it's quite hard to handle with this standard method. So, but with this summability criteria, you can test that for this rational function, there exist g and h, such that this relation is true. And then you apply the double sum to this two sides of this relation. Then you will get this, easily get this one. So you see, once you know how to find the G and H, then usually you can reduce the double sum in terms of single sum. Sometimes, you know this, sometimes single sum is easy to handle in some sense. Why? For instance, there are some known results about a single sum, which show that some single sum is an irrational number. Now, sometimes you will ask how to decide some double sum is an irrational number. Let me take an example. For instance, this double sum, you can take a q just a 2, because then q is greater than 1. I only need a q greater than 1. and then you want to decide whether this is a rational number or irrational number. So the idea is, if you take this binary rational function, by our summability criteria, you can decide two rational functions, g and h. It's quite actually not so complicated. And then you apply the double sign on the both sides of this identity. When you apply double sign to this one, you can simplify this m, because this is already difference with respect to n. So you know this already is a telescoping relation with respect to m. You can reduce double sign by 1, then you get a single sign with respect to n. And then you get this, you can reduce this, you can represent this mu as this form. Here you observe that 1 over 2 times q minus 1 is rational number. And then 2 over q minus 1 is also rational number. And there's a result by Peter Bobbin. He showed that this single sign here is mu 0 is an irrational number. And then by the property of the irrational number, you can claim that this mu is irrational. So actually this is almost so it's already end of my talk. Actually, I should apologize that because I bring some very heavy mathematical knowledge to you, like a genius or something. Actually, here I should maybe, because I have 1 more 10 minutes, because I should explain a little bit. In 1990s, there is a breakthrough done by Zeilberger in this combinatorical research field, because he systematically developed a method for creative telescoping, which is like how you can construct telescopes. And then this idea or this method for creative telescoping was widely used in combinatorics. And actually, before this, I already showed that in this talk, I mentioned a result by Pica. Actually, in more than 100 years ago, there are many people are doing certain kind of creative telescoping. But the problem is, at that time, they didn't realize some algorithm behind what he's doing. So I think the main idea of Zeilberger's algorithm is to help people to do some work with computer, because you can do something algorithmically, which is can be reduce your, for instance, like this kind of identity. In some sense, actually, you can find this identity with computer. You don't need to think, actually. You just run this kind of summability criteria, then you can find it. And then after this, then you see it's quite easy to get some very non-trivial result. So which means sometimes computer can help you to get a very, very non-trivial result if you know how to use computer, like this in this case. Also, nowadays, actually, we realize that even in the people who work on very pure math, they start to use this idea of math, creative telescoping to help them to study some problem in their research field. So, in fact, the talk of this, actually, there is one slide. Actually, I think it's pretty nice, even though, actually, there are no genius. So, so this example is from Manin. So Manin is a mathematician which work on algebraic geometry. And actually, the idea of this Manin's example is you think about this so-called elliptical integrals. You take this edge function, then integrate this edge function with respect to y. And then, because there's a parameter x, so the integral actually is function in x. Then in the literature, there are many people try to find the differential equation, and the name of this differential equation is so-called Picard-Fuchs equation, and they want to find this equation. And then they do many things by hand. And actually, I would like to tell you that we can do this by finding telescopes. The idea actually is very, very simple. You start from this algebraic function, and then you construct this L, such that L is a telescope for F. And then you apply the integral on both sides of this, because this side already derivative of something. And if the integral is the contour, then this integral with this side will be zero, then you can naturally conclude that this integral satisfies this equation. So all those kind of classical work can be done by this method of Kripke discoding. So that's the point.
So this in principle can be done with the Unkripke-Labakov?
Yeah, the idea to do this is the classical algorithm is renamed Unkripke-Labakov. So it's a continued dialogue of the Dieburg algorithm.
And this example is used to Manin or to Picard?
Manin.
And what's the Picard? Oh, so and that's a differential equation that had been known before?
Yeah, yeah. This is Picard and the Fuchs study this kind of equation.
Ah.
So this is.
But in different contexts, not.
Yes.
And Manin did it by hand?
I think he did it by hand. Yeah. The paper of Manin is 1958.
Ah.
So I hope if he can use computer, that's very nice. Yeah, anyway, nowadays we can do this with MAPL. So just this is my point.
So are there other integrals that Manin cannot do that may be of interest?
Yes, there are some examples which you can find in the Christopher Kuchan thesis. There's some very non-trivial identity between the Kummer function and the elliptic functions. Mm-hmm. And then Kuchan, with his factor, he can do this. Mm-hmm. So, okay, thank you very much for the talk.
Thank you. May we have time for questions? I have a question. Is there any hope of extending this beautiful work to more than three dimensions? Four dimensions?
Yes, so this work is just for works in three dimensions.
Yeah.
And there is some future work which is will be done by, in Paris, there's Alain Borstein and his students are working on extending this three dimensional result to four dimensions.
Using your approach?
Yeah, kind of risky approach.
Ah.
Yes.
And once you go to four dimensions, you can go any?
Yes. Actually, we are trying to Aline's student want to extend the method to the four-dimensional case.
Yeah.
And they will use a lot of knowledge from algebra geometry because here
oh.
I already use the genius of algebra curve.
Oh,
in four dimension, there is algebra surface. So there's the invariant is not just genius because for algebra surface, genius is not sufficient.
So you cannot increase the dimension easily.
It's not so easy. Yeah. So, but in any case, we can use some other previous results to speed up the algorithm.
Yeah, we have comments. The Zabug algorithm, in principle, you can get a recurrence, but it takes forever when you have higher dimensions.
You're right. So this holonomic, because your method actually is worked for holonomic input.
Yeah, you mentioned the Kuchan package takes very slowly.
Yes.
Right, to do the three dimensions relative to you.
So let me say something, because actually the Kuchan package not just work for rational input.
Yeah.
His package works for more general input.
Yeah.
But now the question is whether we can do better or faster.
Yeah.
So that's.
Yeah. Once you get that linear recurrence for R of n, is it hopeless to get a closed form expression for R of n?
It depends. Sometimes you can solve this linear recurrence by Petkovic. Petkovic is an algorithm. So there's an algorithm by Petkovic. It can check whether the linear recurrence has a closed form solution.
Yeah, it can decide whether it is a closed form. Okay. In 99.9%, the answer is no.
Okay.
Thanks for a great talk. So we'd like to join Chit a little bit earlier.